guys ready?
Yes.
You all ready? So I'd like to call it order, the meeting of the Nelson County Board of Education. It is Tuesday, January 17th, 2017, at 5 p.m. I'd like to go ahead and start with the pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Board mission statement, the Nelson County Board of Education, representatives of our citizens and entrusted with their children, pledges to support the mission of the Nelson County School District by setting visionary direction through effective policy, oversight, and efficient resource management. Our vision statement is quality education now, learning for life. Dr. Orr, are there any changes to the agenda?
No, ma'am, we have none tonight.
Okay, so then we'll move on to the next on our list, and that's item number three, our student stakeholder engagement.
So we have some young folks from Boston here tonight. If Ms. Call doesn't mind, come and introduce the teacher and the students as you feel best.
We're very pleased and excited to announce, or to introduce to you, Ms. Angela Bennett. She's our music teacher. We share her with New Haven. We very much enjoy her work. And this year, she's decided to restructure the way she's teaching music class to allow for more interest. And the students are actually going to tell you more about why their class changed just a little bit. And without further ado, I'd like Ms. Bennett to come up and introduce her students. We have, and I will tell you this, our students are very involved. So tonight, we have a group of middle school students in LaRue County competing in future problem solving and written composition for the Governor's Cup. We have another group of students who are actually playing basketball game. And then we have another group of students who are band students who were invited to perform tonight at Thomas Nelson for the ball game. So while we may not look mighty in numbers, this is just a small representation of some of our middle school students and the work that they're doing with Ms. Bennett and her class. And I would like to invite her to come on up and introduce us to the individuals who are going to perform tonight. I think each one of them has something to share. Yes. I'm actually going to let the students introduce themselves to you. They're going to be playing one at a time. We have three students tonight. One will be playing the clarinet, we have one on the flute, and one will be playing the guitar, and they're short pieces.
Good evening. With the adoption of new music standards, there is a renewed focus on performance and student choice. In the fall, we were given the opportunity to study an instrument of our choice. I chose to focus on my instrument, clarinet. Although I take a separate band class, I have been able to use this time during general music to focus on things that I need to work on in band, such as my skills.
And that was Miss Victoria Call. Can you introduce your name?
I chose to challenge myself with a different piece of music. There were fingerings that I had not known yet in band and had to look them up. I will play a short excerpt of Under the Sea. I'll perform this piece later this year in our arts showcase.
that was Miss Morgan Stone.
Students who are not in band. Those students were able to choose between instruments such as the guitar, xylophone, recorder, or piano. I chose to play the guitar. Our main objective is to learn to read music or to strengthen the ability and to apply it to an instrument. Students help each other to achieve this, and Miss Bennett circulates to help where she is most needed.
School has been a busy place this month. Fifth grade students have been studying about careers and will take a field trip to APC and Nelson County High School to explore career pathways next week. 15 Beta Club members will be competing at the state convention in arts, crafts, academic, robotic, engineering, and problem solving. Bloomfield teacher Mrs. Bradley and Mr. Metcalf went to a local nursing home over Christmas break and handed out six drain catchers to residents. The residents were very appreciative and amazed at our student work. Sixth grade leader Lauren Fulkerson has been chosen to be a legislative page for this season. Grant Amshaw, Stone Bent, Alex Mattingly, Brett Phelps, and Holden Underwood, all eighth grade students at Boston, participated in KYA, Kentucky Youth Assembly, December 15th and 16th. These students joined over 800 other students from across the state to present and define a BLA creative. We are very proud of our representation of Boston School. According to map data, fifth graders at Cossus Creek Elementary grew significantly in both reading and math. Foster Heights students continue to embrace their roles as leader in our school. Fifth grade students Ashlyn Miles and Catherine White volunteered to lead a school-wide meeting to celebrate student accomplishment and inspire other students to find ways to lead. After the meeting, Ashlyn and Catherine met with teacher leaders to suggest next steps the school could take to facilitate positive change. Their efforts resulted in more opportunities throughout the school for students to lead. Nelson County High School collected 2,700 canned goods through the canned food drive in December for 300 Christmas baskets that were distributed to local needy families. New Haven had completed our future story academic coaching season with all of our students. Every student met one-on-one with the staff member to look at data notebooks and future plans. Students wrote what they wanted to be when they grew up on backpacks and placed on a hallway board to see. We then discussed reading and math goes as well as goes for us. Before winter break, O Kentucky Home Middle School students decorated cookies to give to our police, fire, and EMS workers. We also made Christmas cards for residents of nursing facilities and wounded warriors. The archery team, only in their second year, recently set a school record for points earned and are ranked 12 out of middle school in Kentucky. The second annual Thomas Nelson High School Senior Story Day was this powerful experience for the Thomas Nelson community. In each period, seniors from across the school read personal identity college essays to all the underclassmen, allowing them insight into what makes them who they are today. The stories helped us to continue to take care of each other more profoundly.
Thank you all very much. You guys did a great job, and I appreciate it very much.
I like all the the connecting with community members that I'm hearing.
Yeah, good things going.
One thing I wonder about, and I lost track of the young lady that did the guitar, is that way back there? So did I hear you make a comment that some students at Boston aren't in band, but is it all students are asked to learn something about music? Is that what I heard you saying?
Yes.
And so you're not in band, is that what I gathered? But you decided guitar was something you wanted to learn about?
Yes.
Okay. And I'm kind of curious. I thought that's what I heard. So is that part of something that you're wanting to try and do school-wide? Is that?
I already do it school-wide from 5th grade to 8th grade. This year, because of course Boston is growing so much, I have been moved to the gym, which in the past it has been almost impossible to let students have a lot of choice on individual instruments because of course there are so many students in a small space. But since we're in the gym this year, that has allowed us to allow more student choice. And so I have, all the students have to at least pick one instrument, and I have available at school to them. Of course, they have their band instruments, but we also have a few pianos. We have some recorders, guitars, and xylophones. And the students are also allowed to bring an instrument from home, but we did not have anyone other than band to choose right. to do that.
Well, and am I safe in assuming the two young folks that did clarinet and flute, are you all in band?
Mm-hmm.
You're all in band. Which, by the way, whenever you were playing Under the Sea, all I can imagine was Sebastian, you know, swimming around in this ball going, I don't know about anybody else, but that's the first thing that popped in my head whenever I started hearing you play that. So, going back though to the guitar, what was your reason for guitar? I mean, do you just have an interest in that, or? So it's something then that's just a personal desire and that you'll be able to carry with you through life then?
Yes.
Interesting.
Very nice, and I hate to put anybody on the spot, but Ms. Bennett and Ms. Call, could you guys introduce your students again? Because I didn't get to hear everybody's name.
Well, one was Ariel.
So we had Hannah.
Why don't you guys come
Bemis
back up?
Bemis Jones.
Why don't you come back
yes,
up?
Yes, come on
Hannah.
Up here.
And she's in fifth grade.
Your guitarist,
mm-hmm. Hannah.
So this is Hannah Bemis Jones. And then we have Victoria Call. She was the one that played clarinet. And we have Morgan Stone on the flute.
And your nose reader was Kimberly Bone.
Thank you all.
Good job, girls. Thanks for coming. But I've gone in before and watched them do an ensemble where they're all playing at the same time. Sometimes Ms. Bennett will provide some beat, but it's amazing to me how quickly they learn to make really beautiful music.
Tell me, Ms. Call, which instrument you picked up?
You know, the radio is probably the best thing that I can play. I was sharing back there, I go into the band room sometimes, you know, and just listen, and other students will say, you know, that's, I'm thinking, wow, that's great. And other students will make a comment like, that was good, but the brass was a little flat, and I'm thinking, I don't hear that, because I don't have that kind of ear. But it amazes me the talent that comes at this level, how very quickly I can go in that band room when new sixth graders join and you hear some squeaking and squawking at the beginning of the year, but you know, within the first few weeks, you walk about and you hear some wonderfully beautiful music, and that just transfers into Ms. Bennett's class later in the day. And they get to, what I love and enjoy most is that you get to watch them pursue something of their choosing and learn something that they want to learn. I mean, they're learning the content, they're learning music, they're learning to read music with an instrument of their choosing. And that's something that I think is very important.
Ms. Bennett's next challenge then is getting you to play an instrument.
Oh, yeah. I think I played the dulcimer once many years ago, and I don't remember too much, but.
Thank you, Ms. Call. I think we're gonna get to hear Kimberly again in a few minutes. Really appreciate you all sharing some time with us this evening. Appreciate the staff that makes all of that possible. Ms. Bennett here tonight, Michelle Robinson is the band. that comes out and works with them. And it is, I agree. Sometimes I would, if I were a band director, especially at the beginning of the year, I would want to squawk at some of the noises that you hear, but very quickly they sound fantastic. It's a lot of fun. Okay.
Next on our list is the Expect the Best recognitions.
So every month we recognize a certified certified staff member, which is usually a teacher of some sort, classified staff member, which is a lot of our support roles, a parent and a student, for going above and beyond the call of duty in each of those roles. So I want to read through the nominations that we have tonight, and then we'll bring everybody up all at once because we've got a small token of our appreciation. We want to get to take a picture with you. So I'm going to read through these, and I tell you, usually I try to make sure they're concise, but I couldn't take anything out of these. It was all so good. So our certified staff member is Ms. Sarah Williams from Cox's Creek, and I was actually in her classroom just last week. But Sarah is new to Cox's Creek this year, but she's wasted no time in getting acclimated. She immediately built relationships with the teachers and students she works with, and we hear over and over how hard she works and what a positive attitude she has. She takes on extra duties without question and has the most positive attitude. We're so glad that Sarah has come to work at Cox's Creek, because not only is she great for the students, she's also great for the whole staff as well, and that's very much appreciated. Then our classified staff member is Ms. Martha Parker, and she works in this building. We have people who do really good work here too. Wanda is an outstanding, hardworking, dedicated employee. Her attention to detail as the district finance officer in a time of changing rules, regulations, policies, and procedures is absolutely critical to the success of the whole district. She has for years gone above and beyond to assist employees throughout the district from the time of hire for some to the time of retirement for others. And she is very deserving of the Expect the Best Award. Our parent tonight is Tricia Filiatru, and she's from Foster Heights, but she was unable to be with us tonight. But I do want to read her nomination. Tricia volunteers often to serve the students and staff at Foster Heights. One of her major contributions to the school is her active role on the PTO, where she serves as the vice president. She's a tremendous problem solver and approaches every situation with a growth mindset. One of her biggest acts of service for Foster Heights this year has been to volunteer her time to take pictures of all the staff members, which were turned into Christmas cards and sent to their families over winter break. Tricia has demonstrated that she is committed to serving our students and staff, and we appreciate her support. So we'll be sure that she gets her award at a later date, but we appreciate that. And then Ms. Kimberly Boone, our student from Boston, is an eighth grader with a heart to serve others. She has piloted her True Colors project with our fifth grade girls. This project serves to mentor younger girls and help them find their value and enhance a sense of self-worth. In addition, this is part of a larger anti-bullying campaign within the school. Kimberly meets with students every other week and has an after-school social plan for March. So we appreciate that. So if you folks would come forward, then we'd like to make a presentation and come take a picture with you.
We listen to what he says on post.
All right. 6 miles. good. Give you one more, okay? One, two, three. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Up next on our agenda is item number four, which is our operations consent agenda, and this consists of personnel actions, the treasurer's report, bills and claims, munis report, leave of absences, minutes from the previous meeting, overnight out-of-state trips, fundraiser requests, and educational enhancement opportunity requests. All of those were sent to us in our board packets, and so I'll need a motion to approve the operations consent agenda as presented.
Motion.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second. Second. All in favor? All opposed? Motion passes. Who's on the list? Will be our efficient resource management, and this is our draft budget for 2017-2018. Tim Hopkins, Sewers.
Good evening. While we're waiting to get the document on the screen there, I'll just remind the members of the board and folks in the audience that the draft budget is the first budget in the annual budget process for a school district in Kentucky. The fiscal year in Kentucky, of course, begins on July 1st. This budget is required to be adopted by the end of January. The timing coincides with the staffing formula, which is also an item on the agenda tonight. Of course, at this point in the fiscal year, we're just barely halfway through. There's a lot that can change between now and the end of the year. So we know what we know now. Things will change between now and the time we adopt the tentative budget, which occurs in May, and the final budget, which we approve in September once the fiscal year's actually begun. Just going to focus on some of the highlighted fields. Far right column is the budget column. The columns to the left there, the current year budget and the previous year's actual, as you can see. And the first thing to point out, there's a beginning balance that we're projecting for fiscal 17-18. We're projecting it to increase from this year's budgeted beginning balance by $150,000. The next item that we have highlighted in the budget for you is the tax local ad valorem tax revenue, currently showing an increase of $515,000. That number fluctuates depending on assessments. There's a lot of factors that go into that. We won't know that. We won't get our assessment until around the 1st of August. We get that just in time to reflect the final number in the working budget that we present to you in September. After you've approved salaries, after you've done a lot of things. And we've been doing this for a long time, and we've got a lot of years of trend data. So I feel like $515,000 based on the historical levying record of our board is a pretty good estimate. Carla, if you'll scroll to the next page. One item we've made a change to, we really didn't change it, but I think it's important to note. The biggest single revenue line item in our budget is our state SEEK revenue, and you see that we're currently estimating that figure to be flat for 17-18 from the current year. And both of those numbers are less than we received last fiscal year. We've talked about that over and over, but that is, we certainly expect to receive less money this year than we received last, and are currently budgeting flat revenue from this year to next year. You'll go to the next page, Carl. The only change here that I pointed out is on behalf payments. You know, when you look at our budgets, you see, if you're like me, you're looking for the big numbers. You see a big number on there, draws your attention. On behalf payments are revenues provided the district and expenses, the checks we write or the, actually the state writes on our behalf, and they're called on behalf payments. They're things like retirement matching, health insurance payments, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, those costs are going up. When those actuals are reflected at the end of next fiscal year, they will reflect at least that figure. It'll probably ultimately be more than $7.1 million. Certainly those costs are going up annually. We try to reflect our best estimate of that. We'll go to the next page, Carl. No changes there except, I didn't have my glasses on. Go ahead and keep going, Carl. Here you've got, we talk a lot about our annual step increases for salaries. You all heard that for some time now. The average step increase on our salary scale, if you were to take all of our scales and divide the increase in each cell over the previous salary, you'd come up with an average. I hope that makes sense. You'd come up with an average raise for all those steps across certified and classified, if you average it all, about 1.45%. And that is what we have included as increased salary cost at this point in our draft budget for 17-18. We do not reflect anything here in terms of a hire lag. Sometimes we do see some of that. We'll talk about that more in May. Have more to go on. We'll know more about what potential turnover looks like, how many folks are going to retire, et cetera, when we get further into the year and further into the budget preparation. But all those highlighted fields you see on that page are salary and fringe benefit costs, and those costs are expected to go up by around that 1.45%. If you'll go to the next page, Carl. And you see the same thing here. Again, we continue, all of those are salary codes. Same thing, 1.45% increase. Go to the next page. One thing we did change in our transportation budget that you might recall from the work session, I've got highlighted there 0600 supplies. You know, we have a really aggressive price currently on diesel fuel for our school buses. We've spent over $500,000 on diesel fuel in years ago. We're going to spend somewhat less than that this year because we locked in a fixed price at $1.85 a gallon. We can't lock a price in for 17-18 for a little while. Don't know what that price is going to be. So we've added $50,000 to that line item to try to account for any fuel price increase the board may have to absorb next year. Again, we'll know more when we come back to you in May. Hopefully, by then, we will have brought to you a recommendation for a price for fuel for next year. And we will know in May what that figure should be, or pretty close to it. We know we use about 165,000 gallons of diesel fuel a year to operate our school bus fleet.
Have you heard any projections?
I have not. You know, it's sort of like the stock market. I don't want to get too excited about pricing now and be let down later, or I don't want to get too distressed over pricing if I were to get it now. The further out we were to get pricing, the less aggressive a price we're going to get. Does that make sense? So if we were to try to lock now, we wouldn't potentially get a good deal, I don't believe.
So just out of curiosity, how did you come up with that 50,000? I mean, what was it that said, okay, we're just gonna put 50,000?
It's about a 15% increase, so 27 cents a gallon. To be honest with you, it's thin air. I have no real reason to know. I know that when I go to the gas station, fill up my truck, that really translates what I spend, translates into what we spend as a district. You know, so if it's costing me more, then it potentially could cost us more. So I felt like the safe thing to do, I don't expect it to be a huge increase. In fiscal 16, I think our price was $2.12 a gallon. It dropped to $1.85, substantial drop in fiscal 17. And you know, if you take that back up another, 27 cents, which is pretty close to back where we were the previous fiscal year. I think that's a pretty safe place to budget at this point. I hope it's less than that. We'll just have to wait and see. So, but that is something that we're aware of, and that is a big line item in the budget. We did not estimate any increases for insurance. That's another big line item in the budget because, you know, we've had pretty good luck keeping those costs under control. We'll be bringing that back to you most likely in June. Our insurance recommendations for fiscal 18, and those costs have been pretty well constant. We've been able to keep those under control. Our losses are under control. Workers' comp losses are down. Our mod has been dropping and so forth. So we didn't make any changes at this point in the draft budget as far as that large line item in the budget. Carla, let's see. Let's go a couple of pages. Capital outlay, we didn't have any significant changes there. I think you will go to page 14. Right, you go. Beat me to it. If you'll look, the highlighted figure there, just a reminder, in our the way we handle capital funds, you know, some of your tax revenue goes into a building fund. We receive revenue from the state that goes into the capital outlay fund, and that's the monies we use to make our bond payments. Over time, we pay bond issues down. We just like you do with your own personal mortgages. And the good news is, as we stand today, the unobligated portion, as it stands in this budget, in our debt service fund, meaning the capital revenue we have coming in versus the debt payments that we currently are obligated to pay for fiscal 18, we've got $450,000 unobligated. Now that is up almost $200,000 from the unobligated figure we have of $255 this year. So that's good news. What that means is we're going to be able to set that money aside. We have a roof that needs attention. It's money that we can accumulate into an account and put it towards the next major construction project, reducing the number of bonds we have to sell over time. So that's a positive. That's positive news for the district. Now that number will drop. I think when we come back to you in May, you may recall me saying we're going to be approving bonds at some point for the energy project we approved for Bloomfield, but we're doing that 50-50. Half of that's going to come out of the general fund, and that payment will be covered with savings. The other half will come out of that. So don't know exactly what that figure will be reduced by, but it certainly will be an increase over the unobligated figure that we had this year. So that's good news for future construction projects or needs. Carla? Where are we at? Is that the extent of our highlights? Mm-hmm. Looks like it. Any questions on the draft budget? Again, we expect to come back to you with a little more detail in May. When this version of the budget, we don't even have to send to the folks in Frankfort. They understand that the level of detail that we have to work with now is pretty limited. We're no longer, haven't been for some time, required to submit this to the folks at the Department of Education. That change is coming May, though. We'll have to provide that detail to them. And, of course, the annual financial report and the working budget that we submitted in September, we're required to submit. We'll have more information as the year goes along.
But this just gives us a starting point, so to speak.
Yes, sir.
You do need a motion to
approve. We do, yes.
The recommendation is to approve the request for the draft budget for fiscal year 2017-18 as presented. On your motion.
Motion.
Diane Berry motioned.
Second.
Okay. We have a second. All in favor? All in favor. Those who approve?
Aye.
Aye. Those who oppose? The next is the staffing formula.
It's another item we approve in January annually. We talked about this in some detail at the work session a couple weeks ago. As it stands currently, the only change we are recommending is the assistant principal allocation at combined schools. We currently say if a school exceeds 330 students, they get a position. If they're under 330 students, they don't get a position. Our recommendation is we split that one position into the two combined schools and provide each one of them a half assistant principal going forward. Now that doesn't mean that that's not, we can't come back and revisit that. What it does is guarantee a minimum to schools going forward. We guarantee a minimum for 17-18 in staffing.
I'm gonna jump out in front and say we know we're going to bring this piece back to you because from a conversation we had at the work session last time, we want to look at some other options. And be honest with you, as Tim got into some of the numbers on it, there, we found we had some more conversion work to do. There had been some ways that the numbers that we had reported through school report cards look different from what we expected, so we've got to work back so that we can show you apples to apples on those costs. So we want to get the overall staffing plan approved, but then know that we will come back to you next month after having an opportunity to look at different options and talk about those different options with an opportunity for you to address this one piece. And we're kind of using this as a placeholder for now.
I know, I'm kind of confused.
Okay.
So can you explain that? Yeah.
Well, so we had talked about this one position, this one assistant principal allocation for the combined schools. And Mr. Norman had raised some questions about different ways to allocate that to be really to make sure that things stayed stable at New Haven, but also that we had an equitable allocation for Boston. So we had the one discussion about maybe part-time teacher, part-time administrator was an option. And as I got to thinking about it, I had another couple of ideas that we can add to that. But in order to get some costs attached to it so that you know what the difference in that cost would be for the different positions, but also some perspective on how they would operate within the school and the impact, it's just going to take us a little more time to get that together. We'll bring that set of options back to you.
Okay, so that piece of it is not part of this that we're getting ready to either approve or not approve?
It is. We've put that in there the way it was when we met last time, just as a placeholder, but we're calling attention to it to say we know that we're going to come back and revise this piece of it. And if there's a...
So it lays the minimum foundation, is that what I'm hearing?
Exactly, exactly. But it just, he's got it highlighted there in blue on that assistant principal piece. It's just being very specific to say this part's still in flux because we want to bring the options to you that you have.
Then I don't think that should be a part of this.
Okay.
I think that should be completely taken out and brought back as
okay.
Another item. Because
okay.
if we approve this as it's written, then we don't have any recourse to say, hey, we don't want to, you know, we want to take it back because we don't like the, yeah. I mean, I would feel more comfortable having this piece of it taken out of it.
Okay.
Okay. Is staffing, and I'm not sure if I'm even there, is staffing something that, like this piece needs to be finalized policy-wise, needs to be finalized at this time of the year for a particular reason, or is it more for the budgeting purposes of what we were just talking about?
You are required to approve a staffing formula by the end of January.
Okay.
It doesn't mean you can't come back and approve it without that language and come back and make a change next month if you chose to do that. I will add one other thing. Without the change, we currently have one assistant principal in one school, one combined school, and the other one has none. If we were to look at the projected enrollments, it's very possible neither school would get one based on the current language in the current formula that says you have to have 330 students. So I don't know that I made that clear earlier, because the enrollment, it's possible that enrollment for both those buildings would be below 330. Which would mean neither school would get an assistant principal based on the current formula. We're asking, with this language, asking you to at least guarantee those schools, both of them, at least a half, is what that is trying to do. And then what Mr. Orr, I think, was saying was we want to come back and possibly look at adding to that, or at least providing some other assistance to keep stability in place at New Haven and make sure we provide the necessary help at Boston, if that makes sense.
So you're saying this is regardless of enrollment? So this
yes.
is guaranteeing each school under this formula yes, half of the position regardless of enrollment?
Yes, ma'am.
But if we take this out, then neither school is guaranteed any position based on a current formula that says 330 mandates the position.
That's correct.
But then after the fact, then we can go ahead and we can approve a change.
Yes.
So you can...
So it sounds like it's a couple pieces. One, we got to make sure that the staffing formula is in place by the end of January. If we go with the minimum of this, and I think that's where you were going there. If we go with the minimum of this, we know then definitely both have a half. There's the potential then that later on, whether it's next month, which it sounds like.
It'll be next month.
Then it may even be more than half. It may still be just a half, but at least this way we know at a minimum what they're going to be.
Okay.
And which it sounds like right now, right now one of the schools does not even have a half. Is that correct?
That's correct. They don't.
Okay, but if we come up with a different idea, scenario, you and I talked about it.
Sure.
That does not say a half. What do we do about that?
Well, I'm going to bring you at least two or three, if
options.
Not more, different options. And every one of them that we've talked about over the course of the last few weeks will be in there. It's obviously your choice, and so
we just want to make sure the money's there,
certainly,
to do what we have to do to provide those two schools some sort of an assistant principal. That's all we need to do, right?
Yes.
That's all we need to do right now. Okay.
Right. And you're doing, if you approve it as submitted, you'd be guaranteeing each of them at least a half a person.
And the draft budget is based upon this thinking of a minimum of a half.
Because the net effect is zero, because currently have one position and you still have at least one.
Okay.
And that's okay. I mean,
that's okay, as long as we've got an option to change and we can do whatever we feel like.
If that door's still open, then
as long as the door's open.
Yeah.
We can do more. This just will prevent us from doing less.
That's what I'm saying. As long as the door's open, I'll go.
Yeah, I'm good with that. All right, so the recommendation is a motion to approve the request for the staffing formula for fiscal year 2018 as presented, and I'll need a motion.
I'll motion to approve that.
Okay, Rebecca has made a motion.
Second.
Dane and Jackie has made the second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Moving on to the next item, which is the Nelson County Early Learning Center change orders.
3-5. 3-5. Okay. I just want to say, before we move on quickly, how much I appreciate you being persistent to get to clarity and understanding that you've got my commitment. We'll have it back.
Thank you. You all may get tired of talking about some of these change orders because through our work session process, we've talked about some of these three that we're asking to approve tonight for some time. I'm going to just go over them one more time. Change order number three is $1,066.34 at the ELC. We moved the downspout and redirected potentially water that could have caused a problem into a drain. Change order four, we took out a wall, and because a wall was there, it exposed unfinished laminate on a countertop that wasn't accounted for in the design. That's $345.75. And the final one, the big one of these three, months ago we talked about, through the construction process, we were notified we had a phone line that we were unaware of. And moving that phone line involved some rock excavation to the tune of $5,811.74. I remind you again, on both of our projects, we've got over $100,000 in contingency. We'd like to not spend any of it, but realistically, that's why you have it, because things come up in these projects. If you ever built a house, you know that. I think in both cases, we're under, in the case of the ELC, we're at about 10% of that contingency, around $10,000 in total change orders today.
And isn't the total project, was it three-fourths of
We met today, I'm glad you asked that. We met today, Tom Corbett, I was at the construction meeting today, and he tells us that we're going to be looking at punch list items the end of next month. So that project will be virtually complete the end of February.
And why I was trying to remember that in my head is, while it's not always proportional to be 75-80% or more, it sounds like, done now, and only having about 10% of the contingency having to be dipped into, makes you feel a little bit better that it's being very cost conservative.
Yeah, you know, and again, that's why we've tried to go to the process we've gone to with the work session. You know, I don't see too many other change orders for the ELC coming on you know, down the pike. We've got another one I know that will be forthcoming. We talked about at the work session, but I don't think that's a substantial one in any way, shape, or form. So I think the project's gone really well as far as the percentage of change orders to the total cost of construction to date anyway.
Any discussion? Then the recommendation is a motion to approve the change orders for the Nelson County Early Learning Center 3 through 5 as presented.
Motion.
Dan and Jackie's made a motion.
I'll second.
Dave and Norman a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes. Next is the Thomas Nelson High School change order number 1.
Similar story here. We had a new roof from the new section of the building intersecting the existing wall, and it was determined that I think this was one of Tom Corbett's thoughts. He felt like by pursuing this particular change order in the amount of $2,214.26, that it's safeguarding us from future issues, potentially leaking there. And we've talked about it a couple of times. So we're removing the brick and adding some flashing to avoid the potential for future leaks. Safeguarding against that, and we're asking you to approve that change order, Thomas Nelson.
Any discussion? Okay. The recommendation is a motion to approve the change order number 1 as presented. Any motion?
I'll move that motion.
Dave Norman has made a motion.
I'll second.
Rebecca Guy has made the second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? The motion passes. Next on the list is the utility rate case intervention.
All right, we have three schools that are on KU Electric, New Haven, and the two schools in Bloomfield. Round numbers, we spend on electric those three buildings. Again, we're number 2 in the state in their energy efficiency wise, but we still spend $150,000 a year on electric bills. KU and LG&E have pursued a rate increase with the Public Service Commission in the amount of 6.4%. KSBA is asking that we participate in an intervention, in other words, to oppose that rate increase as best we can. And our portion of that, the worst case scenario, as they presented to us, is $77. So if you figure if we have any luck at all in reducing the rate increase, it's going to be well worth our $77. So we're asking that you approve that tonight.
I make a motion. Yes, I make a motion to join our intervention of the utility rate.
Okay, so Ms. Diane Berry has made a motion. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
David Norman has made a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Okay. And then last on the list, oh, Tim's finished. Thank you, Tim. Is our school makeup day for 2016-2017 calendar. So I guess it's those 2 days.
Yeah, we had January the 5th and January the 6th. If you remember, we missed were snow days. Luckily, that's all we've missed so far this year. Wasn't a whole lot of options to recommend to you without going into spring break or going later into the year. So the 2 days that we've recommended is going to be the 10th of February and the 10th of March. That still allows the 13th of February to be a teacher plan day. We'll have that still in the calendar. All other opportunities were going to put us, again, going further in May or taking from spring break, which I don't think would be a popular vote with our parents.
Do you know off the top of your head what day of the week these are?
Yes, sir. They're both Fridays.
And were they marked as potential snow makeup days?
Yes, sir.
So they built that already.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, does anyone want to make a motion to approve the makeup days, the days that were missed on January 5th and 6th, and making up those days on February 10th and March 10th?
Motion.
Diane Berry has made a motion.
Second.
Dana Jackie has made a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thanks. Next on the list on our agenda is our college and career readiness.
Right before the meeting, I put one of these at each of your stations so you can see our beautiful logo that we're using for the World Readiness Program this year. We've taken the Nelson County logo. One of Nelson County's graduates, Emily Conley, is very kind to me to listen to me pick and poke and make sure it's what we need. And so she has designed this for us, and I think it's pretty awesome that she's a Nelson County graduate and is in the design business. But you see around the logo in the middle all of our core values, and we will talk about those in just a minute. In July, you were very gracious to me in creating a position for college and career readiness coordinator. Ms. Amber Godey worked with me from March through June to help us get some of our activities with world readiness off the ground, and she did a wonderful job. So I talked with Dr. Orr, and he recommended that position, and I will tell you that she hit the ground running, and she's still running as fast as she can, but that's what you have to do in order for students to be successful. Our first activity that we took on together was to begin the process of visiting our manufacturers. So Mr. Boer, Amber, and myself went over to NPR America and talked with their governing board and their administrators, the business people there, as well as we went through a tour of the facility so that we would know exactly how everything would work and if they were welcoming to our students and that sort of thing, just to kind of get the hang of what we were doing before we launched a full approach to the community. We also had an event in September that was a college fair. There were 48 colleges that attended our session or our event. Amber was the primary player in that, even though it did include all of the high schools in Nelson County. Amber was the one who got everything going and on board. Many of the colleges said that they had never seen one so well attended. So she did a great job with that.
I'm sorry, you said all, so it wasn't just Thomas Nelson, Nelson County. We also extended the invitation out to Bardstown City Schools High School and Bethlehem as well?
Correct. There's a regional job fair every year, so everyone takes turns hosting it.
And this year just happened to be our turn.
And next year is also Thomas Nelson's turn, so we did go back to back.
So we began the process, and this is a college and career readiness process that begins with kindergarten. So we're looking at a program K through 12, not only just for high school or middle school kids.
Okay, so following the things that you all just saw on the PowerPoint, in November, I started visiting the co-op placements, meeting with school personnel, counselors, principals, just talking about CCR, how it looks in their school, and what we're kind of moving towards. Have been meeting a lot with the Nelson County Chamber of Commerce, Economic Development. They've been really helpful and receptive to working with us. In December, Thomas Nelson had a senior support day, which included employability and interview workshops. Something that I participated in. It was very nice. It was exciting to see the students' interest in that. I reached out to three human resource personnel here in the community, and they came in and actually taught the students those workshops. At the bottom of the PowerPoint, you will see the beginning list of the schools in the district. And this is just showing you the college and career activities that we've been doing district-wide to show you that all the students have been having equal opportunities to college visits, a lot of the visits to the Area Technology Center. We've taken a trip to the University of Kentucky, the University of Louisville, and the Elizabethtown campus. So I've got to see a lot.
On junior achievement, Amber has gone over to Foster Heights and has worked with their third graders on junior achievement. So she is spanning from little people all the way up to Nelson County High School. She's worked with them as well on junior achievement. She's worked with Horizons doing job searching, employability, that sort of thing. We have had some of Horizon students that have become employed during that time. She has done some career counseling with those students who graduated. We had six students, three from each high school that graduated. at Christmas time, so she had met with them during the week before graduation so that they would have a polished resume, letters of recommendation, and that sort of thing so that they could seek employment. The next thing that you see is that we do work with all schools, and there you will see that the 9 core values are there. I thought it was very important to incorporate those 9 core values because those are the values that the employer is looking for. So we want to ensure that we are teaching that in our program.
Okay, you will see 3 different events listed. Prior to me coming on board in July, the schools had these events. However, since I came in, we've kind of made it like a process, more of a flow. So as you see, 8th graders, they will do Operation Exposure, 10th will do Operation Preparation, and 12th will do Operation Exploration. So a quick rundown of those 3. Exposure is all about letting them know about numerous careers as they are in 8th grade, exploring the big picture. 10th grade gives them more one-on-one, small group interaction with an actual career professional. And then exploration, they actually get a job shadowing day. So of course, through this, I'm constantly in contact with community members, businesses, industries, everyone.
On the grade 12 one, so does that then mean every single 12th grader at a minimum is going to have that one day of job shadowing? I know many of them do co-op where they may be there for half of a day every day, but it's going to give a chance for every senior to have an opportunity.
Correct. And we'll show you a little bit about that.
College and career readiness activities for the spring. Here you see exactly what's coming up. The first thing up there is March 21st. That's the day that we test the juniors for the ACT or with the ACT. At that time, our seniors will be out of the building and they will be job shadowing on that day. So everything's quiet and a good conducive environment for all of our juniors who are testing on that day.
So we are going to have our second annual Nelson Schools Connect Networking and Job Fair. We have a date for that, April 18th. So that's the first event that I helped Ms. Brown with last year. We had 34 participating companies.
It was awesome.
Thank you. And so I hope it to be just as awesome this year is the plan. Planning to send out save the date to those companies, just inviting them back. I sent out a survey to everyone last year, and I think I had 18 replies, and all of them said they're going to come back next year, so that was pretty good feedback. Nelson Schools Connect mock interviews. The seniors will have an opportunity to do a mock interview with a hiring manager or someone from a company. So again, community outreach, bringing those individuals in to meet with our seniors. It's Your Reality. Operation Exposure is the 8th grade event going back here, and so we are adding an It's Your Reality, so they will actually get exposed to a lot of careers, and then on the other side they will go and do a reality store, so kind of making that connection between the career and your reality store. And that will be March 31st, and so I wanted to let you all know, if you all know of any other volunteers or anyone in the community that you all work with that you would like me to invite to these events, please let me know or have them reach out to me.
Do you want my help?
Sure.
Do you want me to help with the interviews?
Yeah.
Mock interviews?
I'll put you on the list.
Okay. I'll put the date on that. March what?
That is March the 24th at Thomas Nelson, and then Nelson County High School's date is to come, but it will probably be in April.
Okay.
We need all of you to keep it swinging.
And I actually participated in one prior to getting this show last year, and I loved it. It was a great experience. And then after you interview students, you get a little bit of time to talk to them one-on-one. So what we try to do, if the student is interested in engineering, I try and match them with a company who has engineers in their company, so then they can, after the interview, they can actually talk about potential job openings after they graduate college.
You don't know this, but this is exactly what we talked about today in Frankfurt. It's just very funny because there's too many schools that do not prepare their students for life other than college.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we both know it, because you go out and try to hire somebody and they don't have a clue. Right. And there, the main thing we talked about was students being prepared not only for after high school, but accountability. How important it is for these students to learn attendance, respect. You know, you just don't go out here and get to do everything you want to do because you've graduated from high school. That gives you no leverage at all with the outside working world. Now, college it might, because you're just going right back to school. But we made a point today where that will be one of the highlights of this year. The commissioner said he wants to accomplish, because there's so many schools that do not prepare their kids for any type of anything. I mean, banking, you know, whatever the responsibility of that student, they don't have clue because they're not taught at home. They're not taught, you know, but people expect the schools to teach everything. So if we can get these kids that don't want to go to college, and it's, or college is not for them, and that's great, but it's just finding the right niche for these kids through this kind of participation. I applaud you. We're way ahead of the game, people. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's helping them make the connection. A lot of these students, I spoke to the six over there at Horizons, and they didn't even know of the option. So, you know, when you give them a few, it's the first thing that makes their eyes open. So yes. That's what we're working towards.
Yes, good job.
So this relates to that collaboration with community partners. On March the 1st, I plan to host a meeting here. I'm calling it a community business meeting. Throughout my past position and just talking to HRs in the meetings and the communities that I'm in now, a few people have expressed interest about hearing about our co-op program. They want to get involved with our career initiatives. So I just decided, why not have a meeting and tell them all about it. Almost a thank you for taking a co-op student. Here's our program, and this is how we can work together. And of course, focusing on those work-based learning, such as job shadowing, just getting more participation. NELCO, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with that, but overall, NELCO is a group of individuals who meet once a month. They're made up of businesses and industries, and they pretty much talk about the economic and industrial welfare of Nelson County. They talk about training, future workforce. So I actually got elected as a secretary in January. So the most exciting part for me for that was I actually now get to know all the HR managers. I call roll every time, so they have to know me, and I have to know them. I've been attending NELCO for about 2 years now, so that was very nice to get that. And then we will be hosting our first NELCO meeting here at Central Office on February the 14th. So again, just bringing people in, starting to get those good connections.
So we have the two events, the ACT and the Senior Job Shadowing District Opportunities. We are asking our schools to put themselves in a Google Doc that they would be available to host students who are looking for education as their profession, so that they can go and shadow a teacher or an administrator or whatever it is they think they want to do. So we have that available with our, we're working with the community, but as well, we are also asking our schools to give them themselves so that we can help students to know exactly what it is they want to do. And this year will be the first time that we know where every single one of these seniors has connected themselves to for the shadowing. So we will have a Google Doc with, for both high schools and Horizons. Some of them will be transported on our buses, others will have their own transportation, but we will have a check and balance system so that we know that they are truly doing that job shadowing piece that we would, that we have asked them to do. So that's another piece that we've added this year to ensure that validity. And what I would tell you is that we've only just begun. This is a long process. We have lots of ideas and we're pursuing them as fast as we can. There are several things that we had to get in place, foundations that had to be built before we could start going up. So we're still working on some manuals and that sort of thing. That's what we did yesterday and today. We've worked with various manuals to get the final copies ready so that we can send those out. So that will be our solid foundation. And then we will build it from there. So I think we're off to an okay start. But I would have you know that better things are coming.
Thank you. I'm going to add one more thing to this job shadowing. So just giving you all an example. In the past, students have went to find their own job shadow placements. So again, I want to help the students find those placements. So the student who wants to be a marine biologist and they can't shadow in Kentucky, hopefully they can go to this list and look for more personnel that's willing to job shadow. So as you can see, the school or the department, of course, this is just our schools, but eventually I'm going to have companies. So on the job title, I hope to have some engineers or some human resource or other job titles, and the students will actually be able to access this and say, oh, I would like to job shadow this person. So hopefully that's where that's going.
Did y'all ever utilize that there was an online, and I forget what it was called, but it was an online something or other where the students can go in and they have like these coaches and HR practitioners like myself. We'll get on there and coach these kids. I forget what the name of that.
Under 81.
There you go.
We have it, yes.
Okay. Is it being utilized?
Yes. And I guess it was not licensed in the spring before. Our county has demonstrated that for you. Are they using it? Yes. To its full potential? No. But that is another piece that we have in place and we're pushing very hard. Yes. We have it. But no, they're not utilizing it as much as we want.
This is the whole reason why I'm here. I mean, it really is. It's the whole college and career readiness. And this is just absolute music to my ears. I mean, it really is. It really is. And if there's more things, better things that's coming, I can't imagine what it is, because this is just amazing. It really is.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
You know, I know everybody knows this fella. He's on television and he goes from place to place learning how to do anything, like make crayons, do this, do that. I don't remember. He does commercials. Anyway, he...
Micro.
Thank you. He said in one, I watched him on some kind of educational thing, and he said that he felt like schools had pushed college on so many kids that that's the reason why we do not have a working force, is because that they've implied you can't get a job without a college degree, four-year degree. And so, and now that college is so out of reach for so many people now, unless you want to go into 100,000+ debt.
And it's getting worse.
And it is getting worse, not going to get any better. And he said that's the reason why he felt that we needed this kind of implementation of these kind of courses, but help for these students, because sooner or later people wonder why plants and other businesses move. This is the reason why they moved, is because there's no workforce.
Well, here's the thing. If we don't get a skilled workforce, and I'm in it every day, if we don't get a skilled workforce, when you're talking about manufacturing, they're going to move to robotics.
Yes.
But they're going to replace the human, is what's going to end up happening.
And right now, there's like 30% is robotics.
Yeah.
They guess 30% of the workforce is robotics. But there's a lot of things robotics cannot accomplish. They need a person.
The other thing, too, is in regards to that, we've all been wired, okay, that when you finish high school, you go off to college, and so it's very difficult to have those conversations with your children to say, you know what, if you don't want to go to college, that's okay. That is probably one of the toughest things to have a conversation with your kid, you know? And so teaching that to the parents that, hey, you know, these are great conversations to have with your kids, and we're going to show you how to have those conversations and make it okay.
Yes, because people think, oh, she didn't go to college. Well, maybe she didn't want to go to college.
That's
maybe
right.
Maybe she wanted to do something else in the world. Maybe she wanted to be a plumber. Maybe she wanted to be an electrician. You go out there and do it.
I like to put it, you're going to college for a career, so it's about getting out there and experiencing it. If you decide you want to go to college a year later, then you can.
And that's
but
okay.
It's all about experience, really.
Yeah. I think one of the things that, you know, that all this kind of wraps around is probably the biggest driver of the economic engine in any community is the educational system that's in that community. So, you know, what's the reason why we've had, what, just over the past 2 to 3 years, minimum of two bourbon industries coming to Barstow, because that's part of what that economic engine in Barson is. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, that connection to the school district and preparing students for that industry, but you become known for something within the community. Bardstown is known for urban capital of the world. But one of the things that we can be working on from that educational standpoint is providing that economic engine for other industries as well within this community. You know, whether it might be the type of industry that you're involved in, or, you know, it could be some robotics in industry, because as more and more of those very labor repetitive jobs are being taken care of by robotics, well, we've got to have the students then that understand the mechanics of that. Exactly. And so, you know, if we're able to show that we have that ability to drive that economic engine in the community through the work that we're talking about right here, that's going to then draw more industry in here. If it draws more industry in, it draws more people. If more people are here, then our community itself economically continues to thrive more and more. You know, we look at like Bullitt County. Some of the things that are happening there is proximity to the UPS World Hub. It's the industries that are coming in there, that population growth that's going on there. So, but some of the same types of things that we can be thinking about within our own community, so that we aren't just focused in on the urban industry, that we've got other pieces that are coming as well. So like you said, it's that foundation, that building block to get that engine going perpetually.
It's also great, I think, that we're working, you know, within Nelson County, but, you know, I would like to see, and I'm sure you are, stretching maybe beyond Nelson County. You know, you've got little manufacturing companies that I work for that's, you know, way up there in the east end of Jefferson County, and, you know, there's all kinds of industry that's outside of Nelson County that, you know, that those options are out there, you know, for our students as well. And obviously, we would love to fill positions right here in Nelson County, and we would love to keep our kiddos in our own backyard, but it's not possible. I mean, yeah, you can, you know, just.
But we're also fine with them staying here, living here, raising their families here, and working in Bullitt or Jefferson County.
Yeah, this is true.
Well, you got Lynn in it, you got Springfield.
We do, yeah. And they're, you know, great communities and, you know, great places to settle down and find that career and raise a family, and yeah, so.
And she can be a plumber.
And she can be a plumber, that's right. That's right. She sure can, absolutely. Yes.
I want to say thanks to these ladies for making this work happen, but I also, and Amber mentioned this in the beginning, we had such a wonderful reception from folks in the community. They're not just working with Amber because she was willing to be the secretary. She's smart enough to know that's a good spot. They're smart enough to know that they've got a good contact with the schools that's out there working on our behalf, but also on the behalf of the community. Without that kind of connection, without the community responding as well as they have, we wouldn't be able to do these things. So we need to thank the community for working with them as well.
I like your approach to it. It's a lot of approach like my boss at my paying job. He watches for meetings that he wants to be nosy and get involved in, so that he can be involved in that action. Same thing you've done there with Nelco.
Yeah, it just keeps me informed on the workforce. You know, my last job, I was in it every day, and so, as soon as I tell, when I'm talking to hiring managers, like, Amber, I have an account, a manager account, and I have an industrial manager, I'm willing to pay them big dollars. And I said, the students don't know that. They don't know what's out there. And they said, well, please tell me. How do I tell them? And I say this, you know, start getting involved with us. So whether it's Bullitt County or whatever, I think the first off is notifying the students what's out there and teaching them in order to get what's out there, you have to be employable.
That's what I'm saying. How do you, okay, let's go this route. How do you advertise? What are we doing to let these kids know that, hey, here we go, you know, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. This is an alternative to whatever, college or whatever.
So she has a job posting blog site where she posts jobs. And we have worked on one job all day long trying to decide what we're going to call it. And so we'll call it one thing, and then we'll think about that for a few minutes or an hour or two, and then we'll have another conversation. We were conversing just before you started this meeting, and she was giving her rationale to me on why she thinks we need to call it this. So she is getting that we have a Nelson County Schools blog post where she posts jobs as they come in and the criteria that's needed. Do they want a 12th grader? Do they need certain skills, or can they drive, or that sort of thing? Is it during the week? She's doing a great job with getting those posts out
to the school so that the students can see what's available. Right now, we have four ready to post when we can make the decision on the name of what we're going to call it. We've got four jobs.
And you put that on? So that's what I was going to say. So this is, you know, new to the schools. They actually have digital announcements, so it's like TVs that they show this.
Like out there in the
yes.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying.
And so
how
what,
do you advertise them?
Right. And so the schools are advertising through that. And what we're working on is a way for the students to actually go to actually a posting blog or a posting site, and they can actually complete the application, and I can just forward it to that individual from there. So I really plan to vamp that up with the networking and job fair. So one piece I didn't do last year was people told me they had job openings, but I wasn't at the school, so I didn't really know what to do with them. And so now I hope to take the job fair, they tell me the posting, then it's on there so the students can forward it.
You're trying to be a matchmaker, so to
speak. I love being a matchmaker, yes, I do.
Just like Indeed.
In jobs, yes. Yeah.
Well, we've also got the Vance Jesse, Mr. Brewer back there in the back. I mean, our area technology center. I mean, that's also a gold mine that we have right here in the community. You know, going back to what we've all been talking about, not every student wants to go to college. Some don't know at the end of high school that that's where they may end up in a year, 2 years, 3 years because of a career they decide to start to pursue. So we've got that advantage of the area technology center that we can also work to try and meet the needs of our community and the needs of our students, because there will be students that the job they want, even if it's not a college degree requiring job, isn't necessarily in our community, but that's what they know they want to do, and we need to try and help them be able to pursue that as well.
I have been working with Mr. Brewer a lot. I'm a huge fan of the Air Technology Center, just because I come from that background, so I know how important it is.
I have to say too, I mean, the school districts that I work with, and just here in Central Kentucky, there's six other areas, or five other, including, plus ours, area technology centers. I think we've got one of the strongest relationships around, because I don't know that I see the area technology center principal at more places than what I do right here in Nelson County. It seems like I turn around, I see them at graduations, I see them at extracurricular activities, involved in school board meetings. It's something that we really have a tremendous relationship with our ETC.
In our leadership, LCB.
And there's not a lot of school districts that say, even though you're not officially a school district employee, you're a state employee, you're still part of our school district, and we want you here because we're all key to making this work.
And you know, there are some classes, courses that they can take at community colleges or colleges that they won't give you, like, let's say robotics or something. I'm making this up as I go. You don't have to have a degree, but you get a certification.
Yes.
Which is just as important as having a degree. And my son-in-law was one of them. Of course, he holds four or five of them because that's what he does. But yeah, and it doesn't cost you as much. And you get help going through school because you're either going to co-op or somebody's got a, you know, somebody's got a niche, and you can fill that niche. And I think that's another alternative that we don't know. I mean, kids don't know about too. Was you don't have to. You can get a certification. Just, you know, I think that's great too.
And I will say, Mr. Brewer also attends NELCO meetings with me. He was the one that nominated me as very
Way to go, Mr. Brewer.
He told you? Is that
he
you
did, mean? But everyone else was like, yes, yes. And I was like, yeah. But he, at post-secondary, is also in those NELCO meetings. And Jeremy is very on top of working with certifications and that. We will definitely keep an eye on.
Yes.
Have you been in contact with Kentucky Bank? Yes, I'm all about it. I worked with it a lot in my last job. I was a huge recruiter for it. Mm-hmm. And this year, she reached out to me and said, hey, can I get in the schools? And so I put her out to our counselors. I know the counselors have many sessions. So yes, if students are interested in Kentucky Bank, they will.
Any talk of a chapter?
Excuse me?
Any talk of a local chapter?
I think the closest is Springfield.
Springfield has a
industrial maintenance. And this is its second year.
You so need to explain to everybody about that.
It just started last year.
So Kentucky FAME is a program in the state of Kentucky that basically what it does is it provides a post-high school certification for students in like industrial maintenance. And there's a couple other pathways too.
two that they work with, but their big thing is industrial maintenance.
Well, and that is each chapter, like you said. So Elizabethtown's focus is industrial maintenance, but like Louisville might have a different one. They base it all on the need. It came together, all the businesses came together and said, hey, we're going to create this Kentucky thing. Do you all need CAD? Do you need industrial maintenance? What is the area that you want to start this with? But I recruited a few businesses to participate in that last year as well.
Good job, ladies.
Yeah, awesome.
Thanks,
good job. You answered everything correct.
Well, you're in my realm. I can answer it.
Yes, good job. Great.
So we don't need anything there, so we can move on to the next thing. And that would be item number 7, student and stakeholder engagement. And we're going to say guest comments. So our policy is any person wishing to address the board may do so by following these rules. Individuals representing themselves are limited to 3 minutes. Individuals representing a group are limited to 5 minutes. Please step up to the microphone, state your name and address, and if you represent a group, state the name of the group you are representing.
I don't see any guests, but if I can jump in, there's something that I need to do. January is Board Appreciation Month. It's a national recognition, but we want to recognize you all. And actually, this has been a really good medium to be able to see what you all bring to the table, both in terms of your own experiences outside of the school board and how that can inform and support the work that we do, but also the accountability piece when you're asking questions and wanting to know what we have and have not done, what we're working on. So we, as a school district, want to say we appreciate the support that you all provide. It's not exactly a popularity contest to get to be a board member, and sometimes it's difficult to stay popular when you're a board member. But we appreciate the dedication that you show, not just in these meetings, but in the work that you do throughout the course of the month that people don't see. On behalf of our kids, if you read the news, you will find that there are boards that don't function nearly as smoothly and cooperatively as this one does. And I want to say thank you as a superintendent, but our schools have also said thank you as well. So you've got a little bit of sample of that in front of you with Chipotle salsa. Is that what it is? I'm having to read part of it. Chipotle salsa that was made up by folks from Boston. And this is just a little bit of a token of it, but each of the schools has put together something of no monetary value that they wanted to give to you to say thank you for what you do in support of the work for our students, and thanks for what you do in support of the work for our community. So we very much appreciate your time and energies and expertise.
I'm just worried seeing the B on the label. I don't know if that's part of that. I'm worried if it's going to sting me whenever I use it.
I just want to make sure to have something ready. Okay.
Have a glass of milk ready. You're supposed to drink milk instead of water. It's too spicy.
Wow.
All kinds of personal experience.
Oh, that's right.
On the board meeting.
That's what we do.
So we have no other guest comments. All right. Then I guess I need a motion to adjourn regular session.
I'll make a motion.
David Norman has made the motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Rebecca has made the second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Meeting has ended. We have to win the executive session.
We do not. We're done.
Okay, good.
You can watch basketball games, Thomas Nelson.